into your presence, into your courts of praise, into your courts of thanksgiving. And Lord God, we are so thankful, Lord God, for saving us, for redeeming us, Lord God, and Lord God, so many instances, and so many, realities and stories, and so many testimonies, Lord God, that you of people being healed, Lord God, from all the way from a headache, Lord God, to somebody being called out of the grave. Lazarus was called out of the grave. He was dead, and Lord God, so many people that were healed of blindness and leprosy, and people were deaf and mute, and so many different things happened, Lord God, that you're not a respecter of persons, what you did then, Lord God, what you continue to do, and you can do the same now, Lord God. We pray for Trent, Lord God, and we pray that he would be healed in Jesus' name. We pray that this cancer would come out, this cancer would be gone in the name of Jesus, and pray that his body would be whole and healed, Lord God. Whole and healed.
Yeah, I mean, it's brutal.
melted and just crying or hugging and all this stuff happened. And it was just so powerful. And then he went from just being super depressed and just, man, you couldn't get a smile on his face. You couldn't just wipe the smile and get so much joy, so much peace. And it was just a change. I wish it could always happen like that. It doesn't, but sometimes it does. Sometimes it does. And I remember just recently, just a few months ago, our buddy, here's Bob too. Everybody's Bob. So I'm in the med bar and I'm giving meds. And so this gentleman comes up and says, "Can you pray for me, Jeremy?" He just asked us, "Can you pray for me?" I had nightmares, you know. And I said, "Look around, there's nobody waiting for, you know, nobody waiting behind him." And so I put my hand on his shoulders, so praying and praying. And the next day he comes up to me and says, "No nightmares." He hasn't had any nightmares since. "No nightmares. This gentleman prayed for me. Boom, they're done."
Jesus is, and they're pursuing him from all parts of this region. They're going to see
They want to see Jesus. They want to see, but let's see why, all right? Sometimes the motives are good. They are. But sometimes motives aren't. I'm just being honest here. Sometimes the motives are, and sometimes they aren't. We're going to go to 22. It says, on the following day, when the people who were standing on the other side of the sea saw that there was no other boats there, except that one which his disciples had entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but his disciples had gone away alone. However, other boats from Tiberias near the place where they ate bread. Everyone say, ate bread. They ate bread.
They ate bread.
They ate bread after the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they also got into the boats and came into Capernaum. It says they were seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here?
They're chasing them for the potluck. They just want the potluck.
They want the potluck after the service or something. You know, they're hungry for that potluck. They're saying, hunger for that word of God. Be desperate. Hunger for that word of God that's going to change us from the inside out. It's going to change us from the inside out. God does want us to change, right? We heard that recently, that God wants us to change. He wants us to behave differently, do differently. And then those things are going to happen as a result of the change that's happening inside. The word of God is going to change us. The word of God is going to change us from the inside out. Does anybody here that's weak that wants to change? Okay, good. I'm preaching to somebody here then. Do we want to change for our families, our friends, for the neighbors, for God, for ourselves? Those are all accurate. And so sometimes we're going to go to the briefcase for option one. Sometimes we have these old clothes on, right? Do you guys recognize this? Anybody? Can you recognize this? What's that? Yeah, it's somewhere, I don't know. It's from somewhere. You know how I got this? I traded for this guy. I traded up. So sometimes we got this old clothes on, right? This kind of metaphor, we got these old clothes on from Egypt. All of a sudden, we don't want to look like Egypt anymore, so we just change clothes. We're just changing the outside. And so we just want to get rid of the old clothes. We get some new kicks, we get this, and here's what we also do. We want to cover up so people don't recognize us. Yeah, we go to church and we do this and that. So we want to spray. We want people to see us differently. We want to put that bomb man on. We want the girls to see we're hot and fresh or whatever the lingo is, right? And so God is saying that He wants us to change. There you go. Get freshened up. Real nice. Freshened up. So God wants us to change from the inside, not just all this outward stuff. We can fool somebody for a little while, can't we? I'm sure I fooled somebody for a little while. Let's get a little quiet in here, you guys. Come on. It's okay. I'm with you. I'm 40 here. Alright, we're going to switch. You guys are going to see how this wraps up here. We're going to switch over to Exodus. Let's go back to Exodus. It's going to come together here. Genesis, Exodus. Alright, Exodus. Exodus 32, somewhere. 32, 22. Okay, we gotta keep it in here, guys. Exodus 32, 22 and 24 here. All right, so here's what's happening. I'm just gonna read you guys a bill and pick it up. Exodus 32, 22. So Aaron said, "Do not let the anger of my Lord become hot. You know the people, that they are set on evil. For they said to me, 'Make us gods that shall go before us.' As for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Okay, this is the first time Moses went to meet with God. Moses went by himself to meet with God, and then this is what has happened, transpires, this is God. In verse 24, "And I said to them, 'Whoever has any gold, let this Aaron speaking, let them break it off.' So they gave it to me. I cast it in this fire. A calf came out." They put all their gold on the Jerusalem. So he's making excuses for their behavior. He's making excuses when they're supposed to. They left Exodus for a purpose. Right? We're leaving the world for a purpose. You guys don't think we're all leaving the past for a purpose. We're leaving the past for a purpose. One of the primary purposes in Exodus and in our life for us is to worship and love God. If you read that, this is what the primary purpose is. They're going to go to the promised land first, but when you see Moses approaching Pharaoh, what he's saying is, let us go so that we can go and worship. That we're God wants us to leave Egypt, leave the world, and pursue God. Worship God. That's our purpose, is to leave Egypt behind and worship.
But they had another idea. All right, we're going to fast forward to, where are we at? 33. Yeah, 33, 7, and 9, I believe here. Yep. All right, just flip a page if you need to. Exodus 33, verse 7. We're just shortening this up. We're taking time to break it down. Moses took his tent. No, I didn't know. I skipped. I said verse 13. You can read that on your own. That's afterwards. Can you read that? All the way up to right now. Yep, that's important. We gotta take care of this though. We're bringing home some points. We can look at that another time. That's important. All right, Moses took his tent and he pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and it called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. And it came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord, they went out to the Tabernacle of Meeting, which was outside the camp. Outside the camp. So it was whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle that all the people arose, and each man stood at his tent door and watched Moses until he had gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass, when Moses entered the tabernacle, that the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses. Moses made it a priority to meet with God. And we're going to see how God really changes us. We get changed when we spend time with God on the inside. We get changed. Our priorities become God's priorities. Our lives, our dislikes, as we spend time with God. God gives us wisdom. He gives us knowledge as we spend time with Him. As in, remember that we read in John 6. Now don't, all the benefits are good. God wants us to see prayer, but the primary is that God just wants us to spend time with Him because He's worthy just to spend time with Him, just a relationship, just to spend time with Him. And then out of that, He's going to show us what to pray for. But the first thing is just to worship and just to praise Him.
These really just jumped out of the page. Hopefully they will speak to you as well.
22nd says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, write these words, for according to the tenor of these words, I have made a covenant with you and with Israel." And so he's having this conversation, this dialogue, and now he says, do this, write this. And so as we have this conversation, this dialogue, and this time with God, believe by faith that God is going to speak and direct you. And listen to what happens here. Verse 28, it says really, really amazing. Verse 28, and it says that, so he was there with the Lord. Moses was with the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights. He neither ate bread nor drank water. He wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. He was with the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights. Just spending time with him. Just that relationship with him. And you go on to read here, this next few verses are so amazing that even when he came down from the mountain, it says that his face, there was an outward shine. There was an outward glow that the people of Israel, they couldn't even stand to look at his face. When he talked to the people, he had to cover his face because of that time with the Lord. That's really what it is. It's that time with God that his face was literally glowing. And you see that in verse 35. Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went to speak with him, until he went to speak with the Lord. He could speak with the Lord. And so the Israelites are with Moses. All right, stay with me for a couple minutes, guys. They were with Moses, and they saw how God had delivered them from the Egypt. They saw the plagues. They saw the deliverance. They saw the mighty, mighty deliverance. And so they saw, the Israelites, they saw the benefits that God had for delivering them. They saw the plagues. They saw him part the Red Sea, and they were delivered. But God wanted even more, right? We've been delivered from this. We've been delivered from that. We've been delivered from X, Y, and Z. But God wants us to take the next step. He wants us to worship him. He wants us to praise him, thank him, honor him, give our lives and submit, surrender, and live for him and see what he wants for our life. God wanted them, and just as much as he wants them, he wants us to worship him, to trust him, to rely on him, as in a relationship. All right, go back to John 6 for winding down. John 6, 28. John 6, 28. They said to him, they said, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? They want to know, what can we do? There's got to be something that we can do. It's by grace you are saved, through faith. It is a gift of God. And 29, Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work, that you may believe in him whom he sent. See, they saw the miracles. They saw the feeding of the 5,000, all these different miracles. But they wanted to believe that Jesus is the great Messiah. Jesus wanted to believe that he is who he is. All right, we're 6:30. Therefore, they said to him, what sign will you perform? They wanted to see more signs, more miracles. Believing Jesus and his word just wasn't enough. What work will you do? Our fathers ate the manna, and this happened, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. They said, all these things happened. What do you do in our time to prove yourself? God doesn't have to prove himself. He is the great I am. Verse 35. And Jesus said to them, check this out. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet you do not believe. All the Father has given me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast away. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I am the source of the provisions. I am the source of deliverance. I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14, 6. He said all these things. But we're going to close looking at John 6, I think 66 here. All right, from that time, many of his disciples, they went back and walked with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, Do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. See, here's his good answer for himself. Verse 70. Jesus answered and said to them, I'm closing with actually the 69. Because it says that another gospel says that this was revealed to Peter, you know, from the Lord basically. The Lord revealed this to him. It wasn't man that revealed that to Peter. And so the Peter is saying, where are you going to go? That you have the words of eternal life. This is how we're closing. God's delivered us from X, from Y, from Z, from all these different things. It's different for each of us here. He's delivered us. And now God wants us to worship him, thank him, pursue him, spend time with him. Not just for the benefits of the bread. He wants us to pursue the bread of life, the one that gave these benefits, the one that gave the that gave that job, the one that gave that family. He said all good things come from God. And so we have to make these choices, these decisions. Now, and also on a daily basis, are we going to continue to trust God? Are we going to trust God even if we don't see how it's going to happen? Are we going to trust God for our salvation? Are we going to trust that God can save us, that he's going to deliver us, that he's going to continue to keep us delivered?
Well, but if you never else did, Lord God, you did more than enough by saving.